How does the series expand the world that was created in the movie?
The show takes place 10 years after the film leaves off, and it's in the same world, but we're following the perspective of the three precogs, who were the center of the pre-crime program, but they were in a milk bath, hooked up to computers the whole time. In the film, Tom Cruise's character, Anderton, liberates one of them, Agatha, from the milk bath, and that's this incredibly memorable part of the movie, because she's essentially an adult fetus. She's had very little life experience other than seeing future murders before they happen. And then at the end of the film, the last shot of the film has the three precogs sitting in a cabin where they've been sent anonymously and essentially witness protection, and reading books and learning about humanity. And they're there far from the world because the closer they are to people, the more they get those visions. So we say, what happened next? What happens when you're one of those precogs? Do you stay on the island? Do you come back to the city? And that's really where we pick up.
Will we see all three of them?
Yes.
I know that Dash is the main
Dashiell and Arthur were twins, and Dash is our sort of main point of view, but both Arthur and Agatha as well are key pieces of the show, each of them has a very different way that they live with that gift.
Was it relatively easy to figure out the approach to this, to use those three characters to go into the series?
Well, because I have an overall deal at Fox, and they said to me a year ago, here's the project, we want to do Minority Report. And I was like, okay, I want to do that. And I would have done the lame remake with Anderton, played by God knows who. And I heard, they told me, well, Max Borenstein, the guy who wrote Godzilla, he did it. And I heard his take, and I went, oh, that's great. That's so genius. But Max, actually, you were watching the movie, and then you were coming to the end of it, like, what's there?
I was going to sit down with these guys at Amblin and talk about it. And I was really excited about the idea, because I remember loving the film so much, but I hadn't seen it in a few years. And so I got it, and I sat down and started watching it. And the whole way, I was thinking, this is great, but if you just do pre-crime, it's a straight procedural that feels like we've now seen it. And we've seen it because people have been copying Minority Report ever since. But we've seen it now before. So I was like, what's fresh? What's a new way to do that? And then you get to that last shot of the movie, and it goes, pre-crime's over. The precogs have been liberated. They've been sent into anonymity. The people who committed those future murders have been released, and people will still sort of watch them. And you go, wow, that's a really interesting world. And what's it like to be them? So it was like, not until the end of the movie that I was like pulling my hair out, like, uh-oh, what am I going to say? And then it was like, oh, that's the movie right there. That's the movie.
I should have watched the whole movie.
That was a mistake.
The question I had in the movie, from the movie, was, you know, can you honestly arrest somebody for a crime they're going to commit?
Right. Well, in the movie, they made it legal, right? And part of the movie, which is so great about it, is it's an allegory and a kind of ethical tale about, well, what's wrong with that? On the one hand, what we would all want to stop murders before they happen. On the other hand, there's a great ethical dilemma, because even though you say you know it's going to happen, but can you change? If you could change the future, if people could change their futures, then they're not going to do it. Then how isn't it? It's Orwellian and evil to put them away. And the movie makes that point. And so we don't want it. That's why big reason why we didn't want to just pick up and say, okay, great, pre-crime is just a good thing, period, end of story. In fact, the movie shows that pre-crime is a very difficult thing and not an ethically clean thing, although it's something that these kind of compromises and trade-offs in security that we think about a lot these days. And so what we've said, and what's interesting for us, is that whereas that was a bureaucratic system run by a police force with laws where you could just be picked, you know, dragged off the street for something you didn't know you were ever going to do, we're now putting this in the hands of Dashiell, who is one of the precogs, who's now, he has to illegally and on his own try to act on his visions, not by simply, he has no infrastructure, no political infrastructure, no judicial infrastructure. He teams up on the underground with a cop, and they have to wrestle with those moral dilemmas themselves. What do you do when you know someone is going to be a murderer, but you have no evidence? And could you confront them? Can you scare them off? Do you follow them? But then what if you get it wrong? Are you using victim as bait? Is that your job? On the other hand, can you play God? You know, and so those kind of ethical dilemmas really become the heart of our show.
And there's chaos theory too. I mean,
absolutely. And there are unintended consequences to anything you do.
What happens when you stop one murder, but it causes three other ones? You know, and so this really rich area to play with, and also so timely in terms of privacy and security, and you know what you trade for one to have the other. You know.
One thing we talk about with the characters is that because we're now in pre-crime, they were isolated from the world, and a SWAT team basically went and acted on their visions. Now the pre-cons themselves are acting on, in our case Dash, he's acting on those visions, and the others are doing it in their own way. But when he intersects the timeline and the path of something that's going to happen, it makes it messier, and that's why he can't see his own future, and so their own future is a blind spot because they can't. It's impossible to predict, and so it gives these great. Even though you say, "Oh, we know a murder's going to happen," it's filled with surprises.
So,
yeah. Go
ahead.
I was just going to say the movie had new tech.
Yeah.
Yeah.
With that stuff.
Which now we have.
Right.
Right. Yeah. Will the show have, are you going to push those boundaries?
Yeah, it's been a huge part, and it's like we feel a real great responsibility following in the footsteps of the movie to push those boundaries. Steven Spielberg talked to panels of experts at every sort of area of science and social sciences to figure out what the world was going to look like 50 years from now, and tried to stay as grounded as he could. And the proof is in the pudding, because you watch that movie and still, we now have gestural interfaces, we now have targeted advertising, and so we've said, well, we've done the same. We have an expert at MIT, at the MIT Media Lab, who's put together a panel of experts, Pulitzer Prize winners, like amazing kind of guy who I'm pretty convinced is going to win the Nobel Prize, like have talked to us and done a little private podcast for our writers of just like, here's what genetics are going to look like, here's what drone technology, robotic technology, soft robotics, it's really insane, and we just take that as inspiration and say, okay, well, how are we going to solve the problems of today in a different way in the future? So that, because that's where you get the wit and humor. It's not just about technology, it's about the humor that you remember from the movie when he walks in and suddenly they're advertising and says, like, you know, he put someone else's eyes in who's Asian, and it's like, hi, Mr. Nakatomi, it's time for your, to get a new pair of underwear from the Gap, you know? And so we have some fun stuff that we play with where, we have a character who sits down on the train, Dash sits down on the train, and a window next to him lights up and starts talking to him with an advertisement, but it's an advertisement for essentially a Starbucks that sells pot brownies. And they're saying, come for our new, wake and bake treats, And so, we just have fun thinking about the future of both technology and also other things that change.
But it also informs the procedural stories and makes them so they don't feel staid. I mean, you're able to do certain future tech and future crimes that are different, that are surprising, that aren't sort of what you've seen before. So it works in many different ways.
So I'm really glad to hear that you're playing with sort of that ethical world of Minority Report. You've got three pre-cons. Are they seeing it differently? Are they dealing with their own culpability and what's going on?
Yeah, one of the big things.
Agatha has stayed on the island.
Exactly.
So she has her own story and her own power, and she's probably the most powerful of the three. Arthur and Dash are in the same city. And so they each have a point of view that you could speak to.
Yeah, well, I think one of the big things about thinking when we were thinking about it is obviously when they're all together, they were like a hive mind, and they talk about in the film, and they talk about Agatha as having been the strongest, and they work like an antenna. But when you separate them, the question is, okay, how did they differentiate in those years out of the milk bath and after pre-crime? And so we started talking about it, and Dash gets this sort of visual component of those future visions. So he gets the kind of fragmented imagery and this sort of haunting emotional stuff that's difficult to make sense of, but that's horrible for him to have an experience in the world. His brother, on the other hand, because remember in the film they also get the names of the murderer and the victim. And so his brother gets that kind of information, names, factual information, which it's not as assaultive to him. And as a result, Dash is this kind of open wound walking around the world, whereas his brother has an easier time acclimating and having social interactions, and he has this sort of predictive ability that makes him, Sherlock Holmes on steroids. And ironically enough, you know, Arthur, the character, is named after Arthur Conan Doyle. And so we get to really play with that stuff. And then Agatha has the sort of, is the strongest because she has kind of what both her brothers bring to the table. And, they're kind of two halves of the whole. And she has a sort of more emotional, intuitive understanding of what's going to be happening, what's going to happen in the future. And so it really, when we eventually perhaps bring the three of them together, it's going to be a crazy thing.
How far in advance have you guys put together ideas for future seasons or into?
We're talking mostly about the first season now. Yeah. We have a deeper game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're going to go, like, I think we're going to air 10, we're going to tear 11 episodes, and then we end in December, and then we have our second season after
the spring.
So we're going to have a cliffhanger right at the end of Christmas.
And Kevin always talks about the pantry in the writer's room when we're sitting there and we're coming up with ideas, and he has this board where that's like, as you come up with an idea and say, oh, it doesn't fit in this episode, it doesn't fit here, it goes in the pantry, and we have this running pantry that's filled with stuff where we're, you know,
seven seasons.
Seven seasons. Yeah.